be holy. A simple instruction. The verses that were read from Scripture today, that's a little subtitle ahead of that section. And I've got some questions to ask you. What does it mean to be holy? And is it possible for us, as mere mortals, to be holy? Questions which I hope I'll be able to answer by the end of the sermon. So taking this in little sections. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Minds that are fully alert and fully sober. This is the foundation of believers' baptism for Baptists. We baptize adults. We do baptize younger people sometimes. The youngest I remember since I come here was 14, that was Sophia. I know that...
I think Ruth was a bit younger.
Was it? But it's unusual to baptise, really. I would personally be happy really with anyone less than 12, I think. Because baptism for us, it's not a little splash on the head. To welcome you into the church. It's not quite as formal, it's not how it works. With minds that are fully alert, so knowledgeable, knowing the Lord, and fully sober. Now, yes, it does have the meaning that not drunk, it does mean that, but really, it refers to mature considering of the relationship with God. And that's what we look for in people that we baptise. And I'm just going to make the point, if you haven't been baptised yet, I don't think there's many here, but there it is, there's the pool. We can make arrangements. Set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ has revealed at his coming. Well, we're all waiting for the coming, but we've all had Jesus Christ revealed to us, or we wouldn't be here. As obedient children, Jesus again said, suffer the little children to come to me, and also that you must be as little children. That doesn't mean that you get to run around and play ball, or not all the time anyway. But it does mean that you have to have that openness of a child's heart, a child's mind, to welcome God into your life. But it does say obedient children. I hope everybody noted that. And like a child, when we first come to Jesus, there's a fount of joy that wells up inside us. And it just bursts out. And we want to tell everybody about it, don't we? John Bunyan, in his autobiography, so to speak, it's called Grace Abounding, to the Greatest of Sinners, which he considered himself, talks about his moment of revelation, where he found Christ and it welled up inside him, the Holy Spirit was working inside him, and he says he was walking along the country lanes preaching to the crows in the fields. Unfortunately, John Bunyan was a very introspective man, And he then had to work his entire life to get back to that joyful point. Because he was always thinking about how he'd let God down and how he could make amends and how he could live a better life. Do not conform to the evil desires you have when you live in ignorance. Think back to the time before you knew God and compare that you with the you now. I can do that. I can compare. I know I've got a lot more patience. Alice would probably say, you've got more patience now? I have. As you know, John Bunyan is one of my heroes. And he, before he got to know God, was called the cussing tinker. Tinker being his trade, and he was known for his bad language. Before I came to God, yes, I used a lot of bad language. But you'll never hear me swear now. It's made me think more, because when I came to God and I started to be able to have that conversation with God, most of the time I was just saying sorry. And as time has gone by, as I walk with Jesus, I have to spend less time, not no time, I have to spend less time saying sorry, and more time asking the more difficult questions, to which I get answers. So what changes has God made in your life? For it is written, be holy because I am holy. That comes from Leviticus. And it's actually in the section about what foods the Jews were allowed to eat. But God wants us to be holy because in that state we are full of the Holy Spirit and the joys of the Holy Spirit. He doesn't want us to be holy because it's boring. He doesn't want us to be holy because there's lots of things you can't do anymore. He wants us to be holy because it is a joyful state. Since you call on the Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as followers here in reverent fear. Followers. So you've got to imagine, as a Christian, you are living in your own country, but as if you are a foreigner. You are in the world. I always say this, you can't help being in the world unless you've got a rocket ship in your back home. But you are not of the world. So think of yourselves as being a guest in somebody else's home. You wouldn't cause strife, would you? Wouldn't cause trouble. You'd leave the place tidy. And that's how we need to go through the world. Without causing strife. Leaving the place tidy. Now that has a whole new meaning with global warming and all the and pollution and so on. Because at the moment we're not leaving the place tidy, are we? Live out your time, as follows here, in reverent fear. Fear of the Lord is a frequent phrase in Scripture. And it's not quaking in fear, put the blanket over your head, hide. It really means listen and do as you're told. That's getting back to being children again, isn't it? We have a Father in heaven. Think about children who are not on earth, who are not afraid of their biological father. They love their father, but they know that they have to do as they're told. a bond, I was a duty officer at the time. For you know that it is not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you will redeem from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. They do say you can't take it with you, don't they? But the precious blood of Christ, man without blemish or defect. This is the heart of the Christian doctrine. We are redeemed by the sacrifice of Jesus. He sits at the right hand of God and intercedes with us because, however much we might want to be holy, we can't manage it all the time, can we? And we need to keep going back to that felt. Going back to the hymn we sang. The blood of Jesus, who intercedes with us, and justifies us, makes us right. And remember, Jesus was chosen before the creation of the world. The hand that threw stars in the sky. And he was revealed for your sake. For yours and yours and yours and yours and mine. And he continues to be revealed. He was revealed to the whole world about 2,000 years ago. But he's been revealed to all of us personally. Each of us, every one. I was walking. My testimony. I was walking beside a canal in Esher, and I was watching the swallows swooping over the water, catching the tiny insects that I couldn't see. And it was so beautiful, and it was so manifestly the handiwork of God. I was in church at some. So, our faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth that is written in Scripture, the truth that was revealed in the life of Jesus, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. Jesus said, isn't he, that the whole of Scripture, the whole thing can be summed up in one sentence. Love your God with all your heart and love your neighbour as yourself. It comes, it's very simple, isn't it? Very simple sentence, but it's very hard to put into practice. How do you put it into practice? A kind word, always a kind word. Open eyes and open ears, looking at your neighbours, listening to your neighbours. Is there some way that you can help? Be it only a few words of advice or comfort. For you have been born again. Let's get back to the baptism. All ties together. Not of perishable seed, not of the human, but through the living and enduring word of God. You have been born again. When you are baptized, you are born again. This next little bit here was one of my mother's favourite sayings. She would say, "We are like the flowers of the field. For All people are like grass, all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers, but the flowers fall. But the word of the Lord endures forever. What does it mean to be holy? Well, it's a struggle. It's a constant striving. You cannot achieve it and keep it and sustain it. You don't get there like that. But you can fall from grace like that. You get there by listening to Scripture, by listening to God, the Holy Spirit, as it comes upon you, and it will do if you pray and open yourself up to it. And remember, the word of the Lord endures forever. Is it possible for us to be holy? Yes, for a tiny moment. Yes, it is. And then we fall back into sinful ways. But you can start putting those little moments together. You can keep going back to the felt. The blood of Jesus, remember the song. You can keep going back to that felt of wisdom and love, and you can give up whatever it is that is wrong in what you're doing, where you are, what you have in here. You can give it up, and you can be justified, and you can be made holy over and over again, because Jesus is there, the right hand of God, interceding for us. I'm not holier than thou, but I'm trying very hard. One day,